موجی از بحران‌هایی که همه را نگران ساخته است. میزان و بزرگی نگرانی‌ها تا چی حد اند؟ آیا پس از یک تحول بزرگ سیاسی در افغانستان بحران‌های دامنگیر این کشور شده است؟ آیا نگرانی‌های نهادهای جامعه جهانی آنچه که آنان یک بحران بشری، اقتصادی، صحی و سیاسی در کشور می‌دانند بجاست؟ نهادهای امدادرسان و جامعه جهانی چی نقش را در وضعیت کنونی افغانستان بازی می‌کنند؟ بالاخره این بحران‌ها مردم افغانستان را به کدام سمت و سو می‌کشاند؟ پاسخ این پرسش‌ها در این گفتگو دریابید. سلام، وقتتان بخیر. با گفتگوی ویژه امروزی ما خوش آمدید. من حامد بهرام هستم و مهمانم امروزی برنامه ما آقای ایلوا فیلیون، رئیس هیئت صلیب سرخ به افغانستان هستند. دیفتر، thank you so much. It's nice to have you here with us today.
Thank
It's a pleasure.
Let
me begin the interview with the question that almost all the countries and the international entities have expressed their concern over the Afghan situation. As the director of the one of the international organizations in Afghanistan, how do you follow the situation here in the country?
Look, we have been here for more than 40 years, so the situation has changed many times in Afghanistan during the presence of our organizations here. Some of us, we've come several times to work for ICRC in Afghanistan, and we have seen the situation changing many times. We have 1,800 staff working today in Afghanistan, spread across the country in many of the major cities and smaller ones. And we are providing services which have evolved through times. Some of them are maintained at the moment, some of them are being expanded at the moment, because we are facing, as Afghanistan and the Afghan people is facing, a new change. I mean, changes in the situation of the life of people, which are affecting many of them. Almost half of the population is actually in need of one or the other humanitarian support today.
Exactly right. Let me ask you the question that the ICRC used to offer some services to the detainees, to the injured people, and some of the warring factions, those who used to got injured in the war. So is there any change in the service and in the package that you people are offering to the Afghan people after the 15th of August?
There's a lot of changes. There's a lot of things that we continue doing, like visiting prisoners, like providing orthopedic services to people who are suffering from missing a limb or some sort of handicap. That these type of services continue, and they are even increasing at the moment. But because of the coming economic crisis with the problems of financing of many services in a country that is caused by the new situation in Afghanistan, we have to make our program evolved into something else. And just to give you an example, in the health sector, we have started last week to financially support 23 hospital structures across the country, many of them here in Kabul, in order to maintain the payment of salaries to the medical staff in these hospitals, in order to maintain the running costs of the hospital, and as well in order to maintain the supply of medical items which are necessary.
You're going to keep doing this because we are facing, beside the humanitarian crisis in Afghanistan, we are facing the crisis in the health sector as well. So it's a big concern for the Afghan people, at this specifically at this situation.
Overall, it's an economic crisis which is deepening day by day, which is affecting the whole population, including the people, including the services. So we are focusing on the health services because this is a mandate that we have, a competence that that we have. There are many other sectors that would need as well similar support, such as the education sector, the private sector, and others, which we cannot focus on. So we are focusing where we can make a difference because we have the competence to do so. But there are a lot of needs that are not covered by our support, unfortunately.
Exactly. You just write in your speech, you said that there are some people, they are still coming, those who lost their bodies, like parts, especially in wars. As somehow I think the war is stopped here in the country. Who are those people who are coming to ICRC for receiving like artificial legs and hands? If you can please tell
sure,
us about
of course.
Those. Who are those
Look,
people?
Even when fighting is finished, people who have lost a limb doing the fighting. They're still in needs after the peace
is there. Change,
of course.
Legs,
so we need to continue supporting them. We have 7 centers across Afghanistan. One of them is here in Kabul. We have Faizabad, Mazar, Herat, right. And in other places. I will not name them all. We receive per year about 150,000 patients to receive treatment. Either the replacement of an artificial limb or physiotherapy treatment or any type of treatment linked with their handicap, with the problems.
These people are coming across the country, it's not specifically
the country.
In Kabul.
Exactly. So some are coming in Kabul, some are coming in Faizabad, some are coming in Mazar-e-Sharif or in Herat, depending on where they live.
That's nice. Let me ask you the question that as per the estimations that the international communities are making every now and then, they're saying that more than half a million of the population in Afghanistan face severe acute of hunger or something like that. What's your estimation? Do you justify these estimations, or the number is high or it's less than what they are saying?
It's difficult to measure because the situation is evolving very fast. What we know is that with winter coming, there will be an increasing number of people who would need either to receive food or to receive medical treatment or to have access to some sort of fuel in order to heat their house and preserve their children from getting sick, for instance. And this, with the season of winter coming, will only aggravate in the coming weeks and in the coming month. And this is why we are enhancing our support to the health sector. This is why other organizations, such as the Afghan Red Crescent Society, for instance, with which we are working in Afghanistan, are increasing their support to destitute people. But there are other many organizations who are trying to improve their work, increase their output, facing that difficult situation.
ICRC already started reaching out these people in case if they are facing a very severe condition in the upcoming winter.
We do for some of them. We do, for instance, increase
our... We are specifically like across the country or specifically in very few places?
But for instance, specifically in prisons, where we are looking at the situation, the dire situations of prisoners facing winter, we are increasing our support into the prison sector. We do increase our support to the health sector because many people will be in need of additional health supports. And we want to preserve the health sector from collapsing because of the economic crisis. We do support the Afghan Red Crescent for them to support many increasing destitute people and families due to the economic degradation of the situation and winter coming. But of course, there are limits to what we can do. But there are other organizations as well doing similar support.
I will ask you about those organizations as well, but let me tell you that beside all these crises that the Afghans have faced, there is something else as well called that the estimation says that Afghanistan has faced a very severe drought this year. So how are you going to predict the future if it really happens, severe drought?
Unfortunately, Afghanistan has been very prone to suffer from climate change. It's not new. It has, I was here 20 years ago already, working in Kabul and working in the north of Afghanistan, and we were already facing regular drought. The situation has not improved for the best over the last 2 decades, I have to say. But this is a global problem, which is affecting specifically Afghanistan, which is already weakened by long decades of war and as well a looming economic crisis at the moment. So this is bringing a lot of concerns. We have, for instance, focus on the support of some farmers in Afghanistan in order to provide them with seeds and tools in order to be able to maintain the next harvest, for instance, linked to the fact that they have lost a lot of their assets because of the past drought. But of course, there are many droughts, concerns about the future drought affecting the country, for which we will have to react as well.
All the crises all came together at the situation in the country. You know, that's why we're going to ask you that the ICRC has a specific plan in order to constrain the situation in the country at this very crucial time.
We have plans. We have plans to increase our activities, to grow actually in providing more services to the people. I mentioned the support we are currently giving to the hospital. This is something new and increasing what we were doing before. We'll continue to grow some of our activities in order to face the growth of the needs of the people. But what we can foresee on a medium to long term is that the needs will be so big that our response as the ICRC, but the response of other humanitarian agencies will not be enough. The depth of the economic crisis, which is only aggravating by the day, is such that there will be more to be done, and there is a need for the international community to realize that and to gather in order to take the right political decisions in order to support Afghanistan at the level it needs to be supported.
So you're saying that you're justifying what the international community and the international organization is foreseeing here in Afghanistan. Like the situation will get even worse?
There is a high risk that the situation will get worse because the economic crisis is only aggravating. And if a political solution is not found in order to bring back the necessary funding into the country, yes, the situation will get worse. And what humanitarian organizations will be able to do would not be enough to support all the needs
in
of the people.
In order to prevent the collapse, economic collapse in Afghanistan, what should the international community do specifically at this situation?
Political decisions need to be taken by enough within the international community in order to decide to bring back more funding into the country in order to support the services, the health services, the education services, the private sector, in order for the economic crisis to stop, basically, and to allow people to sustain themselves.
And what about the unfreezing the Afghan asset, or where the some of the countries, including the United States and the international community, have frozen the Afghan assets? So if they unfreeze these funds, there might be a very huge change in the current situation. Do you agree with this?
There will, obviously, and this is part of the political decisions that needs to be taken at a higher level by the international community, which is not something that the humanitarian organizations such as the ICRC can really influence. We are just calling for a decision to be made towards providing better support.
As the international organization who is presently in Afghanistan, you can see the things from near. You know, you can conceive the things, what's happening, right?
We are raising.
You might have something in order to convey the message to those people. What do you have to do?
We are raising the alarms. Now, the decision is in the hands of those who can make the decisions.
But
we are raising the alarms about the situation. Yeah,
that's right. Let me ask you a question where the international community always expressed their concerns over that, which is a big matter of concern for them, is the human rights in Afghanistan. Since you're present here in the country, how did you find the human rights in Afghanistan, especially the women's right in the country? Has it been violated, or is there any change after the upheavals in the country?
Look, this is, the rights of people, the rights of women in particular, it's always a matter of concerns for the ICRC. This is something that we are following very closely. And we engage with the authorities of the country in Afghanistan, as we engage with any authorities in any country where we work, in a confidential manner, when we are having some concerns about the respects of these or the other rights. We're not an organization like some others do, who are doing public reports about these issues.
I asked you because you're here presently. You know, they are not here in the country. They are always expressed their concerns. So I wanted you to convey the message that everything might be all said here, or there's something changes, or is nothing else. Anyway, there are some meetings and summits over the Afghan situation after the 15th of August. Most of the countries, they have pledged to help the Afghans. How do you follow it, those meetings? Do you see any changes after those summits, after those meetings by the international community, international organizations?
I mean, a lot of discussions are still going on. You have bilateral discussions between some governments and the government of Afghanistan. You have discussions between members of the international communities themselves. These are not necessarily debates that we participated in. We just feed these debates by providing a humanitarian angle to the people who are discussing, to give them the a picture of the reality of the situation for decisions to be taken at the political level. But we do not participate to these
Besides
political
these
decisions.
Political decisions that you're meeting, they're also convening some gatherings on humanitarian assistance. So whenever they have these meetings, are you involved, your organization is involved in all of those meetings, or they're just ignoring?
We are involved into providing a reading of the humanitarian situation, which allows then governments and others to decide, for instance, on how much money would be allocated to the humanitarian response into Afghanistan. And this is, of course, important to maintain that link in order to allow enough funding to come to Afghanistan.
What about the current Afghan authorities? Since you're here and after the upheavals, your organization did not close down, and so you're present here. Do they really cooperate with you in your mission across the Afghanistan, or there's some challenges on the way on your mission?
Look, we are a neutral and impartial organization, which has been created more than 150 years ago to act neutrally during conflicts. And this is what we have been doing in Afghanistan, suffering generally from a lot of attacks, be it in Kabul or in other cities. So we are not immune, of course, for this. But this is the environment of Afghanistan, unfortunately.
It might not be only in Afghanistan, there might be some other countries as well that you're not feeling immune, I think.
True.
So, as you just pointed up about the health sector in Afghanistan, it's on the brink of collapse, like just the other crises that are happening in the country. Recently, you inaugurated your ICCRC on an obstetric structure in Kandahar. So, is there any further plan to inaugurate such sectors across Afghanistan as the civil war really affected the people, especially the health sector? And we are faced with a shortfall of the medicine across the country. Mm-hmm. It's a big matter of concern for the Afghans.
So the opening of this new structure in Kandahar was something planned since a long time. So it took a long time to reach that point to inaugurate a new structure. We have planned to build new orthopedic centers as well for the future in different places of the country. We will see how fast we are able to deliver these plans, of course. At the moment, what is our main focus is to prevent the health sectors and the hospital structures in many cities of Afghanistan to crumble because of the lack of funding. That's our main focus. So we are not focusing on creating new structure. We are focusing on preserving the existing ones from collapsing.
We used to, there's no export and import of the medicine as well, you know, like you can prevent the collapse. But it's on the other side, it's another big issue for the Afghans, you know, at this situation. Is there any new plan or have you talked to any other of the countries in order to reopen these or regain these exports and imports of the medicine to Afghans, not only, you know, preventing the collapse, it's a part of that, I guess.
It's part of the support we are providing to hospital structures across the country today is to preserve as well the supply of medicines to these hospital structures, yes.
In the last few months, due to the vicious war in Afghanistan, thousands of the people have fled the country. It might not be like ICRC is a part of ICRC's plan, mm-hmm. but let me ask you this question, that how do you see the immigration crisis in Afghanistan right now at this situation?
It's a difficult question to answer from Afghanistan itself. This is a question you should ask from people working in an international organization. You might have some of your observations here. It's a question that should be asked to people working in neighboring countries. There is, of course, with the deepening economic crisis in Afghanistan, there is a risk of seeing more and more Afghans willing to leave the country to find a better future elsewhere. That's a risk. And that's why we need to collectively, humanitarian organizations, but as well development organizations, as well as the international community as a whole, to find a way to enhance the support and the financial support in particular to Afghanistan in order to prevent an immigration crisis to happen.
And there are some IDPs as well in the country. So do you cover, do you reach out to those people in case if they have any problems? Of course they have, most of them, they do not have shelters, they do not have mm-hmm. food to have, and they are faced with the very security of food. Yeah. So have your organization reached out to those people at this crucial time?
A lot of people have been displaced because mm-hmm. of the ongoing fighting in the past. And they have been suffering from different situations, the destructions of their homes, or the stealing of their assets, and so on and so forth. Other organizations and organizations that we support, such as the Afghan Red Crescent Society, have been engaged into providing support to these IDPs. We have focused mainly on supporting the people who are returning to their place of origins after having been displaced, either by supporting them to rebuild their house or to rebuild their business, especially towards farmers, for them to be able to go back to tend their fields.
The question in general, international community is concerned that if the emergency assistance does not settle into the country, there is a huge possibility that the country will be socially and economically decomposed. Is that true, or is it just an estimation?
I mean, the emergency supports that organizations such as the ICRC is providing to Afghan in needs is necessary. It's one thing. But it's not enough to prevent the economic crisis to deepen, and the effect of that economic crisis deepening will be multifold and will affect all parts of the population, the structures providing services, but as well the level of the education, as well as the livelihood of people at all levels of the society.
I'm going to ask you about the future of Afghanistan. How do you predict the future in the country?
At the moment, it doesn't look very promising, unfortunately, and we are very concerned about the aggravation of the economic crisis. We're just hoping that by providing the service we are providing, which remains limited towards the depth of the crisis, that it will alleviate part of the suffering of the people. And we hope that our voice will be heard by the international community in order that the right political decisions are taken swiftly for more support being brought to the country in order to avoid the crisis to deepen even further.
So beside all these things that you just said, if you are going to dispatch a message from Afghanistan to the outside world, what would be that?
It would be, don't wait too long. Decision has to be taken now, not tomorrow.
And that's very important at this critical time. Thank you so much, sir, for having you and for your time that you came here and discussed about the Afghan current situation.